Hello everyone, and welcome to Atoms and Sporks. Now if you're a fan of physics, there's a good chance that you've maybe heard of some pretty out there and like speculative physics theories, things like string theory and supergravity, that are all about physics playing out in more than three dimensions. But what you often don't hear so much about is situations where the laws of physics play out in less than three dimensions. And yet these two-dimensional worlds are all around us. And more than that, we humankind made them. We engineered them. They are in our smartphones, in our computers, in our Blu-ray players, which I think is unbelievably cool. And it's what I want to talk about today. Now, at first glance, this might seem like a bonkers idea. I mean, we clearly live in a three-dimensional universe. You can move in the X direction, you can move in the Y direction, and you can move in the Z direction. Three dimensions. But here's the thing. Because of quantum physics and the wave nature of particles, this doesn't actually have to be the case. It's actually possible for dimensions to be frozen out, and the particles in the system will stop following the laws of physics of a three-dimensional universe, but instead start behaving like they truly exist in a two or one or even zero-dimensional world. And if you're wondering what zero dimensions means, we'll get to that. Now, to understand why this happens, we first need to come up with like a sort of indicator or definition for what it means for the laws of physics to play out in a certain number of dimensions. And a nice quantity for this is what is called the density of states. What a density of states graph shows is basically in how many distinct ways a particle can end up having a certain energy. For example, if I have a free electron zooming around, the only thing its energy depends on is a speed. The faster it's going, the more energy it has. But what energy doesn't depend on is the direction the electron is moving in. Let's say I have an electron with a certain speed heading in the X direction, and another electron with the same speed but just moving in the Y direction. While these electrons are moving differently, we say they have distinct and different states, but they still ultimately have the same energy. And this is what the density of states keeps track of. How many distinct ways or how many distinct states correspond to a given energy? And this is directly connected to how many dimensions there are. In three dimensions, any electron with the same speed but pointing in any direction on a sphere will have the same energy. If you crank the calculus on this, you'll find that that gives you a density of states graph that looks like this. But what if we weren't in a three-dimensional universe? Say we were in a two-dimensional universe. How would this graph change? Well, in two dimensions, rather than having a sphere of directions, I only have a circle of directions. There's less options. And again, if you crank the calculus, you'll find this shape. The density of states is actually energy independent in two dimensions. And finally, what if we lived in a one-dimensional universe? Well, then there's actually just two distinct states that have the same speed, to the left or to the right. That's it. And in that case, you end up with this graph. So these are our like dimensional indicators. When we look at a system and look at its density of states, if it looks like this, things are moving, behaving as if they're in a three-dimensional world. But if we see this shape, that means the laws of physics are actually playing out in a two-dimensional world. And this shape is a one-dimensional world. But I mean, clearly we live in a three-dimensional world, right? So what is the point of this long and boring discussion? Well, actually, let me describe to you a seemingly pretty random thought experiment. Let's say I have a slab of some solid substance. Doesn't really matter so much what it is specifically. Could be a metal, an insulator, a semiconductor, whatever. And like we discussed, in this material, there's a kind of gas of electrons, and they will be found to have a certain density of states, which is going to be this one, that of a three-dimensional world. So far, no surprises. Now let's do one thing. Let's make our slab thinner. Let's choose one axis and basically imagine it shrinking along that axis. Maybe we're squishing it, maybe we're shaving off material, doesn't really matter. But the point is, what happens? Well, initially as I do this thinning, nothing much will happen. The density of states will remain the same, and remain the same, and remain the same, until suddenly, once I've thinned to a certain thinness and keep going, it'll start to change. It'll start to morph and separate to look like this, and then this, and then let's just stop here and look at it. Now where have we seen this shape before? Well, that was the shape of our two-dimensional universe. We can actually take this further, and rather than thinning along one axis, we could start thinning on two, basically creating a very, very thin wire.
And as we thin our already thin slab and make it more like a wire, this 2D density of states will start to split again, and this time into that of a one-dimensional universe. And finally, we could actually thin along the last axis. So we're thinning in all three dimensions and basically making our wire into like a little nano-sized cube. And as we do that, the one-dimensional density of states will split into a single line, what we call a zero-dimensional universe. But what is happening here? The name for this is carrier confinement quantization, or sometimes just spatial quantization, where the word carrier, by the way, is just another word for an electron. And this is happening because according to quantum physics, electrons behave very much like waves. And what we can imagine our thin slab is like is a region where the electrons can exist inside the material, which is very thin, and then an area outside the material where it can't exist. And if you take a wave, any type of wave, whether it's an electron wave or the wave on a guitar string, you'll find that if you clamp down on either end of it, that only certain discrete harmonics, or notes if you like, can fit the confinement you're imposing. This is literally how we make different notes in basically any musical instrument. And crucially, as we make our confinement smaller and smaller, the gaps between successive harmonics, or notes, grows and grows. Now, remember, in this situation, we have a confinement and discrete harmonics and all that, but only in this one direction. In this direction, and in the direction into the screen, the slab is still very large, and thus there is still a continuum of states. So every note or harmonic in the confined direction is kind of like a seed or shelf that then a continuum of states related to all the other directions kind of rests or builds on. But it's a continuum of a universe with one dimension less. It doesn't include the confined direction. If we instead consider our nano wire, which is confined in two directions, we then only have one continuous direction, and thus the continuum is that of a one-dimensional world. And finally, if we confine in all directions, which is what we called our zero-dimensional case, there's no continuum at all, and we just get back a line. So, the idea here is that because of quantum physics saying electrons are waves, when an electron is confined along an axis, it behaves as if it was in a universe with one less dimension. But I mean, does it really? This is the density of states of a true two-dimensional universe. And this is what we might find in our thin slab. Sure, for some energies, they seem identical, but they do deviate at higher energies. But here's the thing. Let's say our slab is at room temperature. We can think of temperature as basically the amount of energy each electron has. And at room temperature, that's about 25 millielectron volts. Where in something like a 5 nanometer thick slab of silicon, which is like a fairly typical situation where you see this carrier confinement, this second harmonic is at 250 millielectron volts, which is 10 times higher. No electron at room temperature is ever going to get enough energy to take one of those states. We say that the confined dimension has frozen out. And this is absolutely real. When physicists model systems they care about, for example, how the particles move, how their energy changes with their motion, how they scatter with each other, and so on, electrons in a slab of thin material do all of that according to the laws of physics of a two-dimensional universe, and in a nanowire, the laws of a one-dimensional universe, and so on. And this, by the way, is actually part of the essence of these crazy 11-dimensional or whatever speculative physics theories and this idea of compactified or curled up dimensions in like string theory or supergravity. It is very similar physics. See, imagine you lived in, say, a 5-dimensional universe. And I mean, obviously that's a pretty mind-blowing thing to wrap like our human 8 brains around. But with our old friend, pencil and paper, it's pretty easy to think about mathematically. Your laws of physics in that case aren't described by an XYZ coordinate, because there's actually now two more. Let's say our math plays out in XYZ VW. And you can just then blindly do some math with that as you like. For example, I can do the density of states math again. Here you go. This is the density of states of a slab of material if that slab was in a five-dimensional universe. Neat. But obviously that is the wrong result for our universe. I mean, we can just go out and measure the density of states of a slab of some random material, which assuming it's not thinned, looks like this. Three dimensions. You cannot deny experimental results. But then here's the idea. As far as we know, our universe is infinite in all three directions. In math language, that means that if I'm at a point, XYZ, and let's say I take off a billion kilometers in the X direction, so I end up at the point X plus 1 billion kilometers YZ, well, that is also both a place that exists, and it is a unique and different place than where I was. If I go 6 billion trillion in the Y direction, still a unique place, and still place in our universe. Infinite. But part of the idea of compactification is, what if, for say our two new dimensions, V and W, things weren't the same? What if they were what is called periodic with a periodicity L? What that means is that let's say I start with a point XYZ VW, and I take off a distance of half of L in the V direction. Well, that takes me to XYZ V plus half of L W, and that's fine. It exists, and it's a new place. But what periodic means with periodicity L is that if I then went a further half of L, so that I'm at XYZ V plus L W, well, that point exists, but it's not actually a new point. It's actually the same point as XYZ VW. The dimension has looped. The points V and V plus L and V plus 2L and V plus 3L and so on are all the same point. And no two objects can ever be more than a distance L away from each other in the V direction. And I mean, you can reach for whatever analogy you like, you know, circumnavigating the globe and ending up where you started, or a Mobius strip, or an ant on a wire, whatever, that's fine. But remember, we're just playing around with our pencil and paper. And there, it's pretty easy to handle, even if it warps our little eight minds. And in such a universe, the periodic direction would behave basically exactly the same as our confined slab. Only certain waves, or harmonics, will fit the periodicity, and thus you'll have three-dimensional behavior at lower energies, with higher harmonics of the other dimensions at higher energies. And you know, grossly simplifying, but this is kind of the origin of the idea of a number of these speculative theories. It turns out that there are actually a number of ways where some aspects of physics, like the merging of quantum physics and gravity, it works a lot better if we lived in a world with more than three dimensions. Except clearly, we do not. Experiments show that you can just measure a slab, it's a three-dimensional density of states. But if these extra dimensions are compactified, then we can kind of have our cake and eat it too. Because perhaps earlier in our universe, where the average energy of everything was much higher, things did have enough energy to explore these other harmonics freely. But in the modern day, long after the Big Bang, as energies have come down, we don't see them. Because, like the electrons in our thin slab, relative to how much energy we play with, they're frozen out. Trippy idea, and keep in mind, I'm grossly oversimplifying, but this video was not about speculative theories of everything, it was about technology. So really, the final thing we should discuss is, you know, how unusual or esoteric is this situation with our slab of material and dimensions freezing out? Well, not even remotely unusual. In fact, in the computer chips in the device you're using right now, there is a single slab of silicon into which billions of small devices called transistors have been embedded. These transistors are like little switches of electricity and the basis of the entire computing age. And in these switches, when electrons flow, they flow as what is called a 2-DeG, a two-dimensional electron gas. The electric field in this situation are such that, and the devices are so nanosized that, the electrons exist in a confined 2D world as they flow. And that is not just an academic curiosity. A physicist like me who works with and models devices like this has to do quantum mechanics in reduced dimensions to correctly predict their behavior. And that is far from the only place we see reduced dimensional technology. A solid-state laser, like the one in your Blu-ray player, may have a structure that looks like this, which is engineered to create a sequence of regions where you get electrons living a 2D life. This turns out to lead to some important benefits. Yet another example is a quantum dot, and for example, new quantum dot televisions, which are confined in all three dimensions and thus have these precise resonances. And this is precisely what allows them to emit a precise color, corresponding to a precise energy separation. Finally, you may have heard in the science news about so-called 2D materials, like graphene or the transition metal dichalcogenides, which are sheets of material that are literally just one atom thick. For these materials, any higher transverse dimensional character is so high in energy, it never manifests, even if one atom thick is not truly infinitely thin. They are 2D for all intents and purposes. So reduced electron physics is absolutely all over modern technology. And so, I can't speak for heady theories of quantum gravity, not my field, but in far simpler situations, we regularly face the reality that physics doesn't actually always have to play out in three dimensions. I hope you enjoyed this video. Please like and subscribe if you did, and have a good one.